On the 1st of September 1985, an iconic series burst onto British TV.
This is BBC One, and now we come to the new drama serial for Sundays.
It enthralled millions of viewers as they were invited to spend their Sunday nights on the South Coast.
It became very clearly one man following his destiny and the fallout of that journey.
There's something I have to tell you all.
Tom, if it's another boat, I should go mad.
I've been trying to find the right moment, but, well, there isn't a right moment for this sort of thing. The fact is, I've been made redundant.
Tom, no.
The Radio Times billed it as a cliffhanging family saga of conflict and erotic intrigue.
The start of it is a man who, in his early 40s, suddenly finds he's out of the aircraft industry, has to find a job or make his own way, take a golden handshake and find a business in which he can get involved. He chooses the latter.
The perils of the sea were mixed with the glamour of high fashion.
I'm quite sure that Jerry Glaser knew what the British public wanted. The fact that Dallas and Dynasty were so popular must have prompted him to think, we can give them something like that. We can do the English version of that.
It's heralded as one of the quintessential shows of the 80s and is still popular across the world today. This is the story of Howard's Way, a South Coast saga. I'm Tracey Childs, and for many happy years, I played Lynn Howard.
When will the fish be ready?
Tomorrow, probably. Jack Rolf said he'd ring.
Then we can take her out. Go over to Bewley.
Lynn, you do realise, if things get a bit dodgy, we might have to sell the fish.
You said we were okay.
At present, yes, but if the worst comes to the worst.
You'll soon get another job.
Oh, I'm not rushing into just anything.
Well, you've got your golden handshake.
I want to make that work for me.
I can't see you selling the fish. Whatever happens.
There was a large team of people who worked incredibly hard on Howard's Way. It was an ambitious program, and the BBC knew they were taking a very big risk. The idea for the show required a lot of investment and experience to bring it successfully to the screen. The corporation hoped it would attract big audiences on the fiercely fought Sunday night TV battleground. As ever, when looking back at the origins of successful shows, many people stake a claim. It was one director from the series, though, who is absolutely convinced he first suggested the premise for the programme.
It was actually my original idea. I used to keep my boat an Elizabethan amble on trots. I could never afford to be in a marina. And so I used to dinghy down to a Bugle and have a drink there occasionally. And I sat and wrote a concept for a series. I was actually going to use the Elephant Boatyard, and I called it The Boatyard.
Director Michael E. Bryant.
Jerry Glaister's story editor and I, we had a luncheon date together up in the BBC waitress service. We talked about doing The Boatyard, and Jerry thought it was a great idea and was really impressed with it. It looked like it was going to turn into something. Shortly after that, I went off and I think I got a contract in the Netherlands, or I got a contract somewhere for a year and a half. And during that time, I'm delighted to say, Jerry was able to develop The Boatyard, and he turned it into Howard's Way. And sadly, because I think I was in Amsterdam, there was no way I could be part of the beginning of it. But Jerry got on fine. You know, he was never very keen on boats in the sea, but, you know, he got some advice, and the South Coast is almost next door to the television centre, so it worked out fine. And then as soon as I was finished, I came back, I started directing it, and I brought in the boatyard at Burselden, which I think is now the Sea Line Boatyard, but at Burselden Bridge there was a boatyard, which I remembered, obviously, because I used to drive across that bridge down from London every day, and there was this motorboat yard on the left. And I used to think, what a good place to have a motorboat yard, because you can have lots and lots of boats there and it doesn't cost a lot of money. And we were starting off creating the motorboat stories, and so that became the motorboat yard. It was great fun. I mean, Howard's Way was very much a series. Lots and lots of directors were involved in it. For me, what I tried to do was do stuff like when a boat needed work doing on it, I'd have it leaning up against the piles and the handle and have the characters anti-fouling it on the piles on the hard rather than it being lifted out by a crane and so on, because that was how I always did my boats. And I've always been really lucky in my television career to have been able to join up lots and lots of sea stories with my hobby. And my hobby has given me the knowledge and the ability to maybe know a little bit more about it than I would have done otherwise.
Of course, when the show was commissioned, it would be producer Gerard Glaister at the centre. This was very much his baby. Jerry was responsible for one of the big TV successes of the 70s, a drama series set around a family haulage business called The Brothers. He convinced BBC One controller Jonathan Powell to do something for the 80s that would capitalise on the very distinct mood of the decade. The Daily Star said,
a new BBC series plans to put the naughty back into nautical. The £2 million extravaganza Howard's Way could be called The Brothers Go to Sea. The BBC think the show will last a long time and be a mix of romance, sex, booze and bribes.
It was the time of Thatcher's Britain, where unemployment figures and outrageous contrast beside big fashions and big money-making schemes.
That's the way you do it. You play the guitar on the MTV. That ain't working. That's the way you do it. Money for nothing and your chicks for free.
Dallas was one of the most watched soap operas in the UK. And it was obvious to Jerry that more and more American TV shows were going to be sold to British TV channels. He wanted something to compete with their style and match their incredible impact. Aided by co-creator Alan Pryor, Jerry soon started forming his vision for the show. It was originally called The Boat Builders, a title that writer Jill Higham was quick to change.
I'd just finished Tenko and I was very anxious to do something completely different, so I typecast. Of course, there's nothing more different than Howard's Way and Tenko.
I won't be going into this with my eyes closed. I know exactly what I'm letting myself in for.
Initially, what interested me was particularly in developing the women characters, because in the treatment that I was shown, they were very black and white, nothing, you know, one-dimensional, Jan Harvey, baddie and so on. And I've always worked from character, so that was what fascinated me.
You talk about the years you've wasted. Well, what about me? I spent my whole life building all this for the family. What right have you got to throw it away on some pathetic ego trip?
Our characters. I mean, we have to thank Jill for this completely, because she created the original characters. And when you look at the Avril, Rolf and Jan Howard and Polly Urquhart and people like that, they were driving forces in their own right. And that was unusual at the time. Notorious.
With the title firmly in place as Howard's Way, and the ethos of the series following the ups and downs of the family, the cast was then assembled.
Jan Harvey, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, John.
Howard's Way.
Oh.
I remember watching it on a Sunday night. It was gripping stuff.
You know, it was probably one of the last big television things that everybody did together, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
After that, there was a proliferation of all the different channels, and so people were watching different things, but yes, I think it was 14 million viewers. It's incredible, isn't it?
Incredible. Sandwiched in between Songs of Praise, The Antiques Roadshow and Last of the Summer Wine, no doubt.
Presumably, yes. I can't quite remember, but I think you're probably right.
Do you like talking about Howard's Way, or is it one of these things which have just stuck with you for the rest of your life and you think, oh, why did I do it?
No, not at all. I mean, the thing is, everybody loved it, and it's great as an actor to be in a success like that, you know, and people still come up to me and still, everybody has very happy memories of it, and No, it's lovely.
Mm. And, of course, the 1980s fashion, because you were at the cutting edge of the fashion, because that was part of the storyline, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was great for me, because I got in to see all those designers, like, a year ahead, because obviously they work a year ahead. So we had to make decisions all the time as to what we were going to go for, the look. I remember one year they brought back the miniskirt.
Right.
And I thought, ooh, what shall I do? And Margaret Thatcher said, no woman over 40 should wear a miniskirt. So I thought, right, get the minis out.
Film, did you stay down here when you filmed?
Yes, we did. In the Polygon Hotel, which I am told is no longer there.
Yes, just around the corner from me. Here?
Oh, yeah. Is it still there?
No.
No, gone.
Gone. Houses gone. Now. All houses.
Oh.
There's not even a blue plaque to say Jan Harvey stayed here.
Oh, we had... I mean, I can't tell you. They looked after us wonderfully. We spent 5 years at the Polygon Hotel. I think we started off at the Holiday Inn, but there were too many hijinks and we had to move on.
Because it was it quite good fun, the cast and crew?
We had a ball. It was one of those series where everybody got on, all the crew wanted to work on Howard's Way. It was just lovely. I mean, it was very boring, I remember, for the poor journalists who were desperate for a nasty turn somewhere, you know.
Yeah.
But in actual fact, we were a really happy gang.
And, of course, the Jolly Sailor Pub in Burslesdon, that featured.
Ooh.
Elephant Boatyard,
yep.
The Mermaid Yard. And I love the fact that Hamble High Street was turned into a little bit of Italy.
Look, we were deaf. I remember we were in the south of France, which was down in Lymington Way. And of course, it was freezing cold.
Yeah.
And one rather sort of cutting-edge director decided that to make it look like the house, like the south of France, he should have topless ladies going behind in just with single bikini bottoms.
Blimey.
And I thought, oh, great, you know, you can imagine everybody's listening to every word I say with all these things passing behind us. And of course, it was so cold, these poor girls, it was very, very prominent.
Somewhere to hang your coat.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Immediately before it, I was doing a series called Fell Tiger, also for the BBC, which was in the Lake District and in Scotland, up mountains.
Right.
And in fact, we hadn't finished that. There was a final shot that had to be done, which in fact we managed to fit in around the filming schedule of Howard's Way. So I sort of went with a wig, trying to look like the person I was the previous November. And then it took from that point 6 years.
Wow.
Right the way through.
That's a big chunk of your life, isn't it?
It's a huge chunk. As an actor, it's... And it worried me because, obviously, I thought, am I going to get typecast? Am I just going to be stuck as Jan Howard?
Do you ever watch it back?
I've got the DVDs. I'm so thrilled the DVDs have come out, you know, because those VHSs took up an awful lot of space.
Absolutely.
We were in a supermarket and... I was buying something.
Stephen Yardley.
And this guy came up to me and said, oh, excuse me, Ken, do you get to bonk it? I said, I'm sorry. He said, do you get to bonk it? I said, you'll have to watch next Sunday, won't you?
She did say to me, which I thought was rather odd at the time,
Susan Gilmore.
I think you'll get it, because it's totally right for you, but it might ruin your career.
Just before the first series began, the Daily Express said...
In the wake of the success with America's Dallas and Dynasty, the BBC is making its own glamour series about top people and their family intrigues, based on the Gin and Jags sailing set on England's south coast.
And the Daily Mail secured an interview with Morris, stating...
It has taken Morris Colburn longer than most people to realise one of his greatest ambitions. He had always hankered to go to sea. Now it has happened, fast. Colburn and the rest of the cast were thrown in at the deep end with only a couple of weeks to learn about keels and yardarms before filming began.
Summoned me into a meeting and said, we're thinking of doing this soap opera based on the water, and we've got two characters. We got a character who's been made redundant as a aircraft designer and is well into boats and has designed his own boat, which is, you know, pretty good. and he's thinking of taking it up now and starting his own yard, and we'd like some help.
Bob Fisher was technical advisor for the show, and he certainly helped me to get to grips with some of the powerful vessels we had to sail with confidence on screen.
Tracey really did give it her all, you know, Tracey Childs. So she really did try very hard to do this and used to ask questions. Tom, you know, he too did, and, you know, they were easy to work with. Some of them didn't want to know, but then, you know, they didn't do a lot of it. I can remember doubling it, going down onto the dock to be Jack Rolfe. It really is hilarious. Bobble hats and chunky sweaters, and I'm padded out to be as big as he is. I had no idea that it would grow bigger than all of us, far bigger than all of us. It was really quite surprising, but then how do you know? But he found a really successful formula, and that's what it means. And Jerry was good at that. Jerry was very good at that. And, you know, he was a well-known producer, and, yeah, I respected everything he did. But everything used to happen in these meetings in Shepherd's Bush Green. Then he wanted specific requirements. And the first one was for a boat that nobody else had got. Well, I thought about this, and I realised that I was just about to be loaned, as a demonstrator, a Laser 28, which suddenly became called the Flying Fish. And so I took delivery of this boat, and it really was just what they needed. It was about the size that they wanted. It was 28 feet long, and it had, you know, it could be sailed by three or maybe four people and raced. And so we did, and brought it in, and it was the first boat in Howard's Way. And we kept it going for a year, or just over a year. And then it was the next year that we were discussing was when that series was about to go out. You have to plan these things pretty long in advance. And Jerry sat at the end of this table with a whole lot of eyes staring at me, asked one question. Now, we want a boat that's very different from anything that's about. Oh, yeah? We want one that could extend the cruising grounds for everybody. It's fast and it's light, and really, you know, we want it to go quickly, but we don't want it to cost the earth. And what is more, we want to make sure that more than one of them is built lately, you know, that it's a success for Tom, for his boatyard. And I thought, oh, yeah. I looked at Jerry and I said, you know, if I knew the answer to that, I'd be.
She's an ultralight displacement boat.
What?
Oh, I'll tell you more about it when it's a bit further advanced. If you can spare time from the chandlery, keeping the wolf from the door.
What wolf? Tom, the day I understand boats, you can buy me a new fur coat. I shouldn't worry. It's not very likely anyway.
It's a kind of magic.
And I thought about a conversation I'd had with Tony Castro, the yacht designer, when we were on passage, well, not on passage, we were racing between Hong Kong and Manila in the China Sea race on a boat of his design, a 65-foot boat of his design, which was doing 10.4, 10.3 knots, you know, in 25 knots of wind. It should have been going, you know, 15 or something like that. And I said to Tony, why is it so slow? He said, well, it's a displacement boat. You can't expect it to get up and plane. It's not light enough for that. And this was way before Jerry had got at me. And he said, well, you know, let's talk about it. And so when we were off watch, we got out a pad and sketched out some basics on the boat. And it had to be built in wood, which was a sort of normal material for me, and yeah, we could build it in wood. And I said, well, how big can it be? So he said, 45 feet is as big as it gets, and I sort of went, oh dear, that's going to be expensive. But, you know, never mind, let's look at it. So we then went further into this and how it would be built, and then he looked at me and he said, well, these are the rough lines. Do you want one rudder or two? Well, I said, when that boat heels, that one will be, if you had two rudders, that one would be out of the water. Of centre one would be largely out of the water. Let's go for two. Because you didn't see boats around with two rudders in those days. And so we went for two. And then it just got, you know, when we got into Manila, well, we were busy doing other things. And that got put on one side and forgotten about almost until Jerry asked the question. And while I was there, I was thinking, I said, look, Jerry, I'm going to have to ask for time. Can you give me 2 days? 2 days? You can have 2 weeks if you want, but if you can find the boat, you see? So I said, it might take a little longer than that to build, but yeah, look, give me a chance. I got outside in Jervis Bush, picked up my car phone, because remember you had five phones in a car in those days, and I picked up the phone and I dialed Tony Castro and said, Tony, have you got any of the drawings we made of that ULDB that when we were on the China Sea race? And he said, yeah, yeah, I've got something. I'll look them out. I said, well, start looking them out now. I'll be with you in a couple of hours. So I drove down to Hamble and we got these things out and we started chatting around and how about this and that and the other. And then we realised we'd got to sell the boat to somebody else and we'd also got to get it built. Well, Tom Richardson keeps the Elephant Boatyard just up the Hamble River from Tony. And I wanted to use it for other things anyway. It became the Howards Way Boatyard. It was Jack Rolfe's boatyard up there, you see, when we went on film. But the Elephant was where the boat was built. So then I went down and I saw Saddlers down in Poole and suggested to them that they might like this idea and that I was building what effectively was the plug for their glass fibre mould. And so, yeah, that was what happened. They took the mould from a very shiny hull that we'd built for Barracuda.
Before the cameras even started rolling, the news quickly spread across the South Coast that something big was coming their way.
The location central to Howards Way is the Mermaid Boatyard on the Upper Hamble, but much of the action also takes place on the Solent and elsewhere in the yellow welly strongholds of the South Coast. Tom Howard, played by the actor Maurice Colborne, becomes a partner in the ailing boatyard against his wife Jan's wishes. And if this mere taste of the plot smacks ever so slightly of that successful past series, The Brothers, then you won't be surprised to find that the producer, Gerald Glaister, includes that award-winning series in his credits.
Well, of course, I think always families tend to be a successful thing because, you know, they reflect all kinds of life. There's jealousy and there's greed and there's love and there's, you know, hate and ambition and rivalry. But they can all be found within a family. And so I think this makes it always very good viewing. The difficulty is to set the family in an unusual setting. And I think this is a setting which hasn't been used before for this kind of family saga, really.
Today, the Fleet Street photographers chose to focus their attention on some of the women in the series. Here we have three generations, played by actresses Dulcie Gray, Jan Harvey and Tracey Childs. Expensive yachts give the series its glamorous setting.
Do you think it could run and run?
If the viewers like it, it certainly will. Really, it's just a matter of if they find it entertaining and they find the characters interesting, and they're very diverse characters, then of course it'll run, because this is the sort of thing that one doesn't want to take off if it arouses all the interest.
After the first episode was broadcast, the BBC were no doubt keen to see the reaction from reviewers, James Murray in the Daily Express wrote,
"That's the way to pull in an audience. There is a devilish plot at the BBC to keep us all trapped in front of the TV on Sunday evenings. It looks like we're going to get tangled up with the Howards and their racy way of life for some time."
Even the usually critical letters page of the Radio Times gave way to favourable opinions from readers, with Mr. Williams of London saying, "It's not often I write to comment on a TV or radio programme, but I must make an exception in respect to Howard's Way, which I look forward to all week. A superb cast, all exactly right for the characters they portray, a most haunting signature tune, lovely English settings, excellent photography, a really interesting and believable story. In fact, just what one expects from the BBC at its best."
It was a drama series like no other drama series before it. What made it different, I think, was that it was a touch of glamour that we had previously only seen in US glossy dramas such as Dynasty and Dallas. Some newspapers at the time referred to it as Dallas on Sea.
Media commentator Kevin O'Donovan.
I grew up in Southampton, and it was shot in a small village on the outskirts of Southampton called Bursledon, although in the show that was referred to as Tarrant, which is the fictional place. So quite often you'd have many of the characters having to go into Southampton onto business. So that there was a bit of a thrill in seeing, you know, the Bargate in the city centre, or Lloyd's Bank, as is the case in one of the episodes of the first series. You know, places that you recognise on your TV screen. Southampton was not the kind of place you ever really saw in a dramatic context.
When the first series began, show their appreciation. Episodes regularly attracted over 12 million viewers. Many people all over the country began flocking to the South Coast to sample the many recognisable locations for themselves.
Well, we began the series back in February, and we really had no idea as to whether the general public would actually like it or find it wrong in the time of a very difficult recession in Great Britain itself. The wonderful thing is they love it. And also because I think they love it more than Dynasty and Dallas, because it's British. And so they can relate more to it. And I think we all need an escape at the moment. And I think it's fantastic the way it's taken off. And we're very, very thrilled that the general public have taken to it. And long may they do so.
Set in the fictional Hampshire town of Tarrant, in reality in and about the River Hamble, Howard's Way will run for a second series next year. The combination of family intrigue and picturesque locations is proving irresistible to peak-time Sunday evening viewers. And already the curious from all over the country are coming to see the Mermaid Boatyard and the Jolly Sailor for themselves.
More people have come here. They've come. They're sitting in here for lunch, but they have asked where they're in. Is that the boatyard the series has been filmed? And was it this particular house in the village? So they're certainly around and asking. Several people have said, you know, that there are lots of people wandering around the village. They don't like people peering in their gates, you know, or generally knocking on their doors, which is several people have said to me. They're knocking on their doors and asking, is this the way to the Jolly Sailor, or is this the way to the Mermaid Boatyard, you know? So it is a bit of an inconvenience.
If it's an inconvenience now, what will it be like as the series' popularity grows and grows? The Southern Tourist Board have started planning guided tours. You've heard of Hardy Country. Next, it'll be holidays the Howard's Way.
There are only five hotels in Southampton that can accommodate a tour group.
Yeah.
The Post House, Polygon, Dolphin, Moat House and Southampton Park. Those five hotels we have a very, very close relationship with, and they will also see the benefits in Howard's Way continuing for a great number of years.
The Tourist Board claims to have coach operators clamouring to visit the film locations. But one local woman who lives on a boat moored on the Hamble has grave reservations about the scheme.
Well, as a boat owner, I'm not very happy about the idea. After all, boatyards aren't playgrounds, and people could be wandering around and just through inexperience or ignorance of the situation inadvertently cause an accident. For example, there could be a boat shored up in the yard and somebody could knock the props away and the boat could fall down on that person, injuring the person and seriously damaging the boat. Children could perhaps injure themselves on tools or pieces of wood or something lying around. And we don't know who is going to be responsible for the costs of any accidents that might occur, for start. And if somebody was injured, I mean, would the boat owner be responsible for the damage to that person? Or would the boatyard? Or who? That's one problem that really concerns us.
Have you noticed that there are more people around already?
Definitely. There are a lot of people just at the moment looking around. They're enjoying themselves. And I'm quite happy that people should enjoy themselves. But there are a lot more coming this way and asking questions and just generally treating us a bit like monkeys in a zoo in some ways.
John Gilman's house is right on the waterfront, and he too is wary of the way his village might be exploited.
I can understand the reasons behind it, but I think it would need to be done with the greatest discretion, because it isn't a village that's adapted to receive large parties of people. Narrow little roads, very limited parking. So I think discretion must be exercised if it's not going to be throw away the baby with the bathwater.
This little corner of Hampshire may soon be as famous as the Yorkshire Valley that's home to Emmerdale Farm. Thousands make the pilgrimage there every year, so guided tours down Howard's Way may not be as far-fetched as they first seem.
I assume they're getting me in with the tour. I haven't heard about this yet, and I hope there's a jolly good wage for it. Otherwise, I'm in with the tour, and it's jolly cheap. But yes, it's extraordinary, isn't it, that people should be so interested that they want to go around. I can understand it. The actual locations are beautiful, and it's an extraordinary piece of countryside. I hope they like it, as much as we did when we were there.
Of course, it wasn't just the sights of the South Coast that are remembered so fondly by fans of Howard's Way. The epic theme was courtesy of trusted composer Simon May.
Jerry Glaister invited me to write the theme for what was then called Boat Builders, which became Howard's Way. So in that year, 1985, was a golden year for me. I wrote two of what I might call my best, at that time, themes. And working for the BBC then was a wonderful... It still is. I love the Beeb. It's good when you're there, if you're in the right place at the right time, which I was. I never analyse when I'm writing. I just sit down and my fingers move over the keyboard. And if I kind of go into a flow, and if I get, goosebumps surge into the, right up the centre of my body, and I get emotionally moved, that's my only criterion. Howard's Way is a very simple melody, actually. And that took as long to write as I've just taken to play it. And that's how it should be. I was so knocked out when I actually saw the titles with my music on it. I was bowled over. I think the theme tune was one of those iconic kind of 80s sounds that is very much of its time, but 30 years on, it's still remembered. It's still that kind of instantly hummable theme. Midway through the series, around about season 3 of the show, a vocal version sung by Marty Webb was issued.
Of course, Michael Grade, who was top man at BBC at the time, very commercial, and anything that promoted the show was something that he was in favour of. And also BBC Records thought it was a good idea for commercial reasons. But you shouldn't really write a commercial recording just to have a hit record. It should be first and foremost right for the programme. Always There, the Howard's Way version, it wasn't a massive top 10, but it stayed in the charts a long time. It was definitely a top 20 hit.
It was just quite an odd thing, because here we had this glossy TV drama on every Sunday night with a really instantly recognisable theme tune, and then the next thing you know, it's on Top of the Pops with Steve Wright and Simon Bates.
There's some really nice sloppy tunes on Top of the Pops this week, and in the charts generally. Here's one of the nicest. It's Always There. The ladies in the studio, it's Marty Webb.
the hit series Howard's Way, there's Marty Webb and Always There.
Great song too, another sloshy song on Top of the Pops.
I'd like to think we're a bit ahead of our time, actually, yeah. As well as, you know, just having the main theme, every time one of the characters had a moment of drama, then we put in their theme to go against it. And if the theme, like Frere's theme, was quite sort of bold, arrogant, dangerous. Abby's theme was much more feminine. Different themes, you just put them in against under their dialogue or when they were walking by the sea or whatever, and it I think it did bring a different dimension, and I think that Howard's Way viewers sort of related to the music as they did to all of the characters, the acting, the scripts and everything, and it all kind of worked.
It's an old cliche to say pub shut early, but as the ratings of the show grew and grew, the effect was noticed across the whole country. People would make an appointment to watch each episode on a Sunday night, and the popularity of the show became out of control.
Howard's Way, the series which left viewers on the edges of their seats last summer, is back in August. Filming has been going on at Burselden, sometimes known as Tarrant, for the last few weeks. Today, all the cast were on hand for a photo call, but no one was giving anything away about the new series.
Tony, you play Charles Frere in Howard's Way, who is something of an oily millionaire. Do you get any nicer in the next series?
Oily? What do you mean, oily?
Well,
no, I don't get any nicer, no. Well, I don't know. I mean, up to episode 8, I'm still not a very pleasant character. Pretty ruthless, pretty determined. Doesn't really care who he tramples on.
How have you enjoyed playing the millionaire?
Oh, well, I mean, it doesn't alter my home life, except when I try and go and buy clothes for myself, because the clothes they buy for me for the show are wonderful, and the clothes I wear is me, pretty drab. But I love driving the Bentley. I love being on that yacht. They haven't let me drive the chopper yet, but...
Without giving anything away, are there any real surprises for viewers in this series? Because it finished on a bit of a cliffhanger, didn't it?
Oh, yes, well, we do resolve everything. Yeah, we resolve all the cliffhangers that we left. And so I don't think that there'll be any disappointments. And, of course, we open up a whole new series of events. I've promised this time that I won't leave the second series quite so much in the air.
Now, if you thought the last Howard's Way was expensive, this series is costing upwards of £3 million. Much of that money is spent on cast's clothes, and something like £100,000 worth of costumes kept under lock and key in Southampton during filming.
Well, we're using Yuki this year, Louis Farrow, companies like Stephen Marks, you know, people like that, Nicole Farley.
Do you not get nervous when you see them being used in filming?
Terrified, especially on days like today where it might pour down, you know, and I've got people in linen and silk and things like that, yes. They're usually in wellies below the silk skirts and moon boots.
Much of the action in Howard's Way centres here on the Mermaid Boatyard, known in Burselden as the Elephant Boatyard. Despite the invasion of the Howard's Way film crew and cast, work at the yard has been going on much as usual. Howard's Way has brought instant fame to Burselden. Business at the Jolly Sailor pub is booming. There are special boat trips for those who want to take a closer look at those famous locations. And for the real addicts, as a taster for the new series, there's even the chance of a weekend break the Howard's Way, courtesy of Southampton City Council.
Listen, people are saying it was a bit quick, this falling in love and getting married. Is it going to last?
Well, I hope so. We're really trying to keep the marriage together and, you know, we'll just do our best. You'll have to keep tuned in to see if it's going to work.
You're not a bit of a fly-by-night character. I mean, who would trust a man with a ponytail, for
example? Well, exactly. That's what I ask myself. But, I mean, she seems to be absolutely desperate in love with me. Everyone seems to think that Claude Dupont is a complete genius. Mm. So we can only hope that it keeps on the rails.
Of course, you're not French. I noticed you haven't got a French accent anymore.
No, that's right. Well, I have been quite gratified that people have actually thought that I was French, so that was rather nice. It has been a challenge playing this character because the antecedents of French characters in England are, you know, we have Hello, Hello, and Peter Sellers playing Clouseau, and the French accent somewhat ridiculed, so I did have to tread quite a tender line in order to make the accent plausible.
You mean just sort of subtle enough, in other
words? That's right, yes, that's right, to make it so it wasn't ridiculous.
But can you just switch into it like that?
No, it takes me a little while,
I mean, if I said something to you like, you know, comment allez-vous, what would you say?
I wouldn't understand what you were saying.
Of all television programmes nowadays, none are more talked about than the soap operas, which is why the open-air programme was putting Howard's Way under the microscope, and why the wedding dress worn by Lynn Howard at the weekend was getting another airing. It cost £1,500 to make, and yet viewers complained they hardly got a glimpse of it.
Producer asked for a dress that there was, only that dress, an original, and this is what I did.
Can it be used again for anything?
It could be. I doubt if it will be used for anything again, but, you know, maybe in a few years' time. Yes, it might be.
So it's not sold off at some market or anything
like
that?
Oh, no, definitely not, no. No, it goes into the costume department.
The new daily access programme, Open Air, hopes to be around for quite a while. If Open Air does half as well as Howard's Way, it won't be doing badly. The soap and water opera pulls in 13 million viewers each week. But what's the success?
I think it's part because people can identify more with these characters than they can with the American equivalents. It is reasonable. As somebody said to me today, it's possible to think that at some time in your life you might be able to acquire enough money to buy a boat. It's not possible to think in billions with an oil well.
It turned out that really we managed to get it down to two filming blocks a year. One after Easter, sort of in May, and the other in August. And they lasted for about 10 days, maybe 2 weeks at a time.
Elephant Boatyard owner Tom Richardson.
They didn't impinge on our sort of working life. The only thing we were aware of is we didn't want to interfere with our customers doing things on boats more than we had to, because when the programme had gone, we wanted our customers to continue keeping their boats with us. So that everybody worked really well together, and it was a very happy association over those 6 years. In fact, Glyn Owen was great because he realised that this wasn't just a launching for the show, it was actually a launching for all the people who had built the boat. And suddenly I looked round and all the guys in the yard who were sort of in the background had all vanished. Glyn bought them a barrel of beer in the jolly and was having a proper launching party in there for the guys who worked on it. So that was a special moment.
So what was the plot of Howard's Way? Well, it certainly started as a drama series, but some argue it got more soapy from series to series. In summary, Tom Howard invests in Jack Rolfe's boatyard and starts an affair with his daughter, Avril Rolfe. Jan Howard splits up with Tom and goes into business and into bed with Ken Masters. Then after Jan's business takes off, her new designer and son-in-law, Claude, is killed in a boating accident. Jan gets together with Sir Edward Freer, but then splits up with him. My character, Lynn Howard, gets over the death of her husband, Claude, and goes back to former flame Charles, who nearly caused her to die at the end of the first series. Although Abby gets her own back on her father, Charles, who is also the father of her ex's sister's child. And the series finally ends with Jan Howard celebrating her son, Leo, taking over the boatyard that was formerly his father's. Episodes continued to attract audiences of over 13 million viewers. It seemed this was firmly the jewel in the BBC's Sunday crown. Although in 1988, disaster struck. During the filming of the fourth series, the technical advisor Bob Fisher was sailing on the Barracuda and the vessel ran aground. BBC South Today reported on the incident and assessment of the damage.
She's sitting in the yard of Ancaster Marina in Cowes, and she looks a pretty sorry sight. The mighty barracuda of Tarrant now has more holes than a calendar. The man who owns the boat is Bob Fisher, the sailing journalist and broadcaster. Naturally, he's feeling pretty depressed about it. He's also feeling pretty sheepish because he was on watch in the dark hours of Monday morning when she ran aground on Bembridge Ledge.
I said, come on, we've got to get this jibe in right now. Start hauling that mainsheet. And in water, the hull was OK, but the keel was bouncing up and down on the bottom. And, of course, the other five on board were coming up like animated earwigs out of on a pogo stick. You know? Didn't really think that we should be doing this, so it was a horrendous moment.
Both Bembridge lifeboats came to the rescue and pulled her off the rocks. She sank in 4 fathoms of water. But with the help of airbags, television's most famous sailing boat was refloated and eventually brought to Ancaster. There's a lot of damage. The rudder's smashed, propeller bent. All the electronics and the engine will have to be overhauled. The total cost, around £30,000.
You know, seeing it in this state is horrible. Absolutely horrible. But the one joy is that we know that it will live to fight another day.
The question is, how quickly? She's one of the original stars of the TV series Howard's Way. The programme wanted her for a sequence this very Friday. That, obviously, is out of the question. The target is June the 5th, the start of the transatlantic race. The Howard's Way storyline demands that Barracuda take part. For Bob Fisher, this is a new sort of challenge.
And we are trying every which way to get a lot of people involved. I'm hoping they might be able to do some of the, perhaps, subcontracting on the job. I've just taken a look. There's no rudders left, and there's things like that. All that's got to be sorted out. So there's probably going to be more than just one yard involved in the repair of the boat.
Despite accidents, there was still plenty of positive publicity for the show in the papers in 1988. There was even one national paper offering a glitzy weekend away down Howard's Way as a prize. Perhaps slightly ironically, under the headline, £3 million a series, but the Isle of Wight ferry had to cross the QE2. Then, at the end of 1988, the press discovered the news of a new cast member. Kate O'Mara.
Doctor Who, the brothers, Cresmorel in Dynasty, and now Howard's Way. Mm-hmm. What sort of a part are you going to play, Kate?
A tough, glamorous, independent businesswoman. Charming, but ruthless. Allowed to look very, well, as beautiful as I can in every scene, and totally wipe the floor with the men. It's an ideal role. It's my favourite kind of role.
Have you ever sailed?
Yes, I have. But mainly as crew, you know. I mean, I was always sort of bunged down to sort of cook the meals and everything. But I do know that one of the good experiences was sort of sailing out and then in the middle of the sea, diving off and swimming around. That was great fun. It's the best way to swim, I think, off the side of a boat.
Some of the other actors and actresses on Howard's Way have actually bought themselves a boat.
Yes, it gets to you now, I believe. I believe it gets to you. I shall wait and see how it affects me.
Look, I don't know what game it is you're playing.
This is no game,
Just
Laura.
Because you have acquired a few more shares in Leisure Cruise doesn't mean to say that you can influence the board or unsettle me.
I'm trying to warn you, that's all. And it's not only the board at Leisure Cruise that are losing confidence. Some of the directors at Poelma are concerned about this distribution agreement you have with them that's coming up for renewal.
Yeah, well, that's hardly surprising, is it? When you consider who the new managing director is.
I could always try and persuade them not to break the agreement, but, the board at Leisure Cruise are losing confidence, and you lost this lucrative deal with Poelma. You could find yourself in deep trouble.
All right, Ken, you've made your position clear. Now tell me what it is you want in return.
I heard you acquired those House of Howard shares.
Aha, so that's what you're after.
Why do you have to look at everything so cynically, Laura? I just happen to think the company has a future.
Oh, yes, I'm sure you do.
...1989 was a tragic year for the team working on the show. In August, Maurice Colburn passed away suddenly.
I filmed his last scene. I filmed along the edge of the Hamble here.
Director Robert Reed.
He was out track running, and he was tremendously fit. He did several takes up and down, and he said, would you like me to do another run? I said, well, you sure? You know, because he was panting. He said, no, I'll do another one. We did another one. and put it all together was fine, and, well, I don't know. He didn't make the next show. It was terrible.
The following year would see the final series of Howard's Way grace TV screens across the country.
There's a limit to storylines when, let's face it, we're based here in a boatyard on the water, and it's about people who build boats, sell boats, design boats, and have other businesses as well, glamorous businesses. So there's a limitation there. And I don't think it showed during the run. I think the run finished at the right time, on a high.
The show is still fondly remembered by many fans, and there are always rumours about a revival.
But I think it's just general surprise that, you know, they've suddenly realised that this is the place out of the series. A lot of the locals were extras just because this is their drinking hole, and for a lot of them it still is.
John Pilcher is the current manager of the Jolly Sailor.
It was nice in the connection for me because, as a boy, it was one of those things I used to watch. It's almost, it's a cult. It's huge, really, for this community because of the involvement that the community had. It's an important tourist aspect for us, but also for Basildon and for Southampton as well.
You've been listening to Howard's Way, a South Coast saga. The show was presented by Tracey Childs and produced by Richard Latto and David Allard. For videos and extended interviews, go to bbc.co.uk/Solent.